The United States says its sanctions on Iran have been crippling the country's economy. But the government of Iran doesn't seem fazed by them. Is time running out on the West's showdown with Iran? I'm Mike Walter in Washington, D.C., and this is The Heat. In his State of the Union speech earlier this week, President Barack Obama once again warned the government of Iran that the West will not tolerate Iran's pursuit of a nuclear weapon.
The leaders of Iran must recognize that now's the time for a diplomatic solution, because a coalition stands united in demanding that they meet their obligations, and we will do what is necessary to prevent them from getting a nuclear weapon.
But Iran remains defiant, and just hours after President Obama's speech, Iranian officials announced the installation of new centrifuges for enriching high-grade uranium at the country's main nuclear facility. So much for ultimatums from U.S. presidents. So is a nuclear-armed Iran unavoidable? What options are left for the U.S. and its European allies? Joining me now to offer his insights is Prince Reza Pahlavi. He's the son of Iran's last Shah, the late Mohammad Reza Pahlavi. And he is also one of the most prominent voices of the Iranian opposition. Prince Reza, thank you for coming in and joining us here on The Heat. We just heard President Obama. I want to get your reaction to that, but something that was kind of a little different. Normally, when there's a statement by the President of the United States in a State of the Union address like this, it's followed by a pledge to support the Iranian people in gaining freedom and democracy in the country. We didn't hear that in this speech this week. Does this signal a shift in the U.S. and its policy towards Iran, do you think? Are we reading too much into this, or what are your thoughts?
Well, I've always maintained that what happened 34 years ago in Iran was the coming to power of a bunch of people with a particular ideology, which had nothing to do with the deep desires of Iranians and what Iran is all about. When I hear various heads of states, including American presidents, refer to Iran as a threat, I would first of all propose that they rephrase and say the regime is a threat. Iran has never been a threat. In fact, Iran has always been a peace-loving country and contributing to the world community from centuries ago. Attempting to find a reasonable entente in a sort of coexistence with this regime is futile. Let me tell you why. The essence and existence and purpose of this regime is to export a religious ideology. And for them to survive in this ideology is to defeat the West and everything it stands for. All the values that we recognize in the world today, in the free world, democracy, human rights, and so on and so forth, is poison to this regime. They cannot coexist. Their aim is to destroy the West. And if they do it, and the more means they have to be able to impose their hegemony, they will. That's in fact why they need the nuclear issue, for them to survive. It's almost like asking this regime not to breathe anymore. They need that. It's part of their entire game plan. So insisting on diplomacy is a waste of time.
You say nothing has changed. Would you say that about the United States' policy, too? I mean, it seems as though sanctions seem to be the effort the United States takes to apply pressure. Over time, it doesn't look as though they've worked. If President Obama were to say, Prince, give me some advice, what might it be?
Well, my first word, not just to the United States government, but to many foreign governments that have been part of this package of economic sanctions to bring pressure on Iran, is that the entire premise, again, is faulty. The whole purpose of imposing sanctions was not to cause regime change in Iran, but behavior change by the regime. Again, it ties back to my previous comment. You expect a reasonable behavior by this regime. They won't. Therefore, the only impact that the sanction has had, ultimately, if it's only with the objective of forcing the regime to change its behavior, which it won't, is ultimately going to hurt the people.
You've expressed some disappointment in President Obama, and then there are critics who say that his policy towards Iran is too hawkish. How would you, and you're shaking your head no, it's not hawkish enough?
Well, look, first of all, let's understand what we mean by pressure or hawkishness. Hawkishness doesn't necessarily mean being a warmonger. But soft diplomacy has not worked either. President Obama, just to prove that he's different from G.W. Bush, particularly in the outcome of 9/11 and what happened in Afghanistan and what happened in Iraq, was to say, well, I'm not him, and I'm sending a message. America's not at war with Islam, and so on and so forth, and his whole world tour within the Muslim communities, and engagement with the Iranian regime. Well, let's rewind tape to 4 years ago, and let's not forget what happened in 2009 with the election fiasco. Again, if you follow the same rationale that I just explained, it is the same old policy of trying the same matter of approach again. The name of the administration has changed, but the policy apparently still is the same. And if I recall correctly, Albert Einstein once said that thinking that by doing more of the same you can achieve a different outcome is a sheer sense of insanity. We're doing the same thing and expecting a different outcome.
You mentioned us as Iranians. Obviously, you feel a kinship to the people in Iran, and you'd love to see regime change. What's going to be the tipping point, do you think? What would cause that?
Well, look, as the clock is ticking, diplomacy has failed. We cannot jump directly from failed diplomacy to war and striking Iran militarily, whether it's an Israeli initiative or whoever else's initiative, because that's lose-lose. It's not going to solve the problem. The better way, and a much less costly and far more legitimate way to bring about change, that is to bring the change at the hand of the Iranian people by helping them directly to foment a movement that can ultimately force the regime to paralysis and collapse by means of nonviolence, civil disobedience, but carefully orchestrated, packaged, led, and supported by the international community. You do the math, it's going to cost much less. It will not be a scenario of conflict and war. It will not be a threat to the regional stability. And the outcome, most importantly, will resolve in one shot several problems. The problems you have with proliferation, the problem you have with terrorism and radicalism, the peace process between the Israelis and the Palestinians, and many other issues that ultimately could bring our region to real stability. But the will has to be there. So I think if that decision, which is yet to be made, is made in time, we can, in fact, avoid a scenario of conflict. But that window is tight. Therefore, action needs to be taken now.
You and I had a chance to talk briefly before this interview, and I asked you about the election. You said, what election? You don't really hold it in high regard, but do you have any predictions or thoughts about it?
Well, it would be insulting to call this mockery of a process an election in the sense that you talk about elections in any democratic country. And as such, it has always been the regime fronting a pre-screen candidate and trying to play with people's heads and survive just a bit longer. But nobody is taking the system seriously or legitimately. What the people are really frustrated with is that when they cannot overcome this regime easily as a result of its severe repression, they don't see, on the other hand, any real support for change. They hear a lot of lip service. They hear a lot of claims about we support the Iranian people or we support the Iranian people that, coming from the mouth of an American president or some other world leader. But in reality, you continue negotiating with this regime and its representatives only, and there's no real dialogue or support for the real forces of the country that are democratic, that are peace-loving, and represent the great majority of the Iranian nation.
You know, when I look at you, you can see a little bit of your father in you. Obviously, there's a striking resemblance. You were a teenager when he fell from power. If there was a way to turn back the clock and go back in time and give him some advice, knowing what you know now, what might you have said to your dad about his leadership or his style? Or do you think there's anything that could have been done to change history?
You know, should have, could have, would have. I don't think that way. I'm the kind of person who moves forward. I don't get stuck with what happened. I may want to analyze it. I may want to question to see why something happened the way it happened. But I'm not stuck in it. I think the objective should be, now what? Where are we now? Where do we want to go? It basically means foresight. When you look at the founding fathers that were the basis upon which America became the country that it is today, at the time, You could have imagined that now that you think of it, you say, oh my God, they really thought it through. There was really a lot of anticipation, a lot of foresight. Well, again, this foresight should be the result of having learned from something. Old Europe and the lessons drawn from there led to all the ideology or philosophy that led to the Declaration of Independence, that led to the articles that formed this country. Now, each country may have its own sets of history and references, but it's always this objective of moving forward that should be key. Learn from the past and move forward. That, I think, is the most obvious lesson. And today, in this world of communication, you can reach millions of people instantaneously, as opposed to what it was 200 years ago or even 50 years ago in Iran.
Well, speaking of moving forward, unfortunately, we have to. Prince Reza, thank you so much for
joining
us. Thank
you for having me on your program.
When we come back, the view from Tehran. That's coming up in just a few moments. Stay with us.